for me, I always compare food to sex.
Really?
Because I think
it sounds like an interesting.
No, contrast. Because I think it's it has to excite you. I think the first bite has to be as exciting as the last bite. And for that, I call it always sexy food.
What is John George Vongerichten?
First of all, it's my name. I mean, I wish my parents would give me a shorter name because my last name is very long. So
you must be from Alsace, obviously.
That's correct. That's so, right. You know, the food is a German discipline on the French kind of innovation. Grandfather was a coal handler.
Really?
Because we have a canal right behind the house.
Yes.
And the coal was coming from the north.
Yes.
On boats.
Yes.
You know, traveled by horses.
Yes.
And then the coal was distributed to the city. So I was always black when I grew up. I was
serious?
Full of dust.
Come on,
and yeah, I'm serious. My grandmother and my mother were cooking every day for about 30 staff. I grew up in the morning waking up with all the smells in the kitchen and food was more my interest, and my father wanted really me to pick up his company, and I turned it down. The turning point for me was really when I went to 17.
Yes.
Birthday, they took me to l'Auberge de Ville in Alsace. And I was eating, I was like, amazed about everything. And on that meal, when I arrived on dessert, I said to myself, this is it. There were 80 people here, laughing, enjoying, eating, the smell, the restaurant, the energy, and the thing. And I turned to my father and said, you know what? This is what I want to do. I started there then the 14th of July 1973.
Yes.
It was a three-year apprenticeship. Yes. So I arrived and the first thing that I learned is about seasons. I started actually in summertime, so it was all the live eels coming from the river, the wild salmon at the time, strawberry, raspberry, it was summertime, and then you turn into the fall, and I was like pheasant with a feather.
Yes.
The hunting guys were coming with.
What was Harbrilling like?
I mean, it was like working next to God, you know. I mean, the guy has all that knowledge. He learned from a chef who was one of the chefs from the Tsar of Russia.
Yes.
So, I mean, it was like very bourgeoisie, and etc. So mixed with the Asian food. So for me, but he was the nicest guy in the world. When you start working in a three-star restaurant, it's like entering the mafia. I never wrote a letter to find a job. I wanted to go to the south of France, to Louis. It was a phone call away, and 2 weeks after I was there.
Yes. What was different about him?
He was against having anything on the stove. I come from like Alsace, where everyone was, we were doing stews and soups and
more
stocks.
Yes.
We were cooking for hours and hours.
Yes.
Here I come in the kitchen, I had to erase everything I learned for the 3 years.
Yes.
Start from scratch, because he started with nothing.
So he was doing everything a la minute.
A la minute, that means.
What an extreme!
Somebody ordered a fillet of sea bass. You take the sea bass actually from the fridge, cut it. He was going with some champagne sauce. It was cooked a la minute, reduced a la minute. The herb was chopped a la minute. He wanted, at 12 o'clock, the stove was empty. After that, I said, I want to see something else again. Phone call again, Monsieur Routier called Monsieur Bocuse. And I was there 2 weeks after.
What was Paul Bocuse like?
Same thing there. I come, this is Lyon. And I was like doing 2 years of like olive oil,
yeah,
basil.
Yes.
Erased everything again. I mean, you put it inside of your mind.
Yes.
To start from scratch, you know. But I was cooking next to him. So it was an incredible on a character, on a charisma.
Yes.
On a,
yes.
He's the one who really.
But he brought the chef out of the kitchen.
Absolutely.
Before that, the chef was hidden in the kitchen.
So I learned that from him, you know.
Yes.
Diversify yourself and
yes.
Be a consultant in Hong Kong or London.
Be flexible.
Be flexible. And then I went to see, I went to Munich to another three-star restaurant. At the time, it was a Tendris.
Yes, Tendris. This was
Mr. Wiesingman. He was a bit like Uche. He hated mise en place.
Yes.
He hated people prepping ahead of time.
Yes.
So he was putting the menu on a wall at 5 o'clock for 7:30 opening of the restaurant. And that menu was on for that night on the next lunch. Every day, you had no idea what you're going to cook. The guy was in Germany. He went to Hebalin, Bocuse. He went to travel in Japan. So he was a bit like cooking in New York.
Yes.
He had no fears, no tradition. There was no rules. And then I get a phone call from Monsieur Routier from Oasis. How are you? This is Louis Routier. I have a consulting job in Bangkok, at the Oriental Hotel. I'll set you up, you cook my food, and you go there.
And rock and roll.
I said, let me think about it. No, you cannot think about it. I need an answer tomorrow. Head of the plan.
Yeah.
The smell was different. I knew right away this is different. You know? I mean, it smelled like rice, it smelled like nampla, yes. It smelled like, you know, it smelled like anything, but nothing I'm used to. It was a culture shock, a total culture shock.
And how many years did you stay there?
2 years. I was a chef at the Normandy for 2 years.
Yes. And what did you learn there? What did you
learn? It changed my life completely.
What was it about that place that changed you?
I mean, because I was like, wait a minute, now I come from Europe, every sauce has to be a pot with some bones or some fish shells, and you cook it for at least an hour, 2 hours, 10 hours, whatever, depending on which kitchen you work in. And here they are, they put a pot of water, some lemongrass, and 10 minutes after you have the best soup in the world. All the seasoning is liquid, there's no salt. Yeah. Most of the food is seared very quickly, you know, with a wok, or it's quickly cooked, so it's always fresh. It's not, I mean, there's some curry who has simmered, but it's, like you said, the fragrance, it's very fragrant. Everything's
yes.
Very fragrant.
Yes.
With the spices on. But for me, I cannot go back now. I mean, the spice is my life. I think when you conceive a place, first of all, you think about it in your head first. Because
so you've already done it in your head.
I mean, after 25 years of cooking, you know what salmon tastes like.
Yes.
So already you have a start. So you know salmon is kind of fatty and soft.
Yes.
So you're contrasting with something crunchy.
Yes.
It's my Asian background. On
yes.
And then, but I still want it to taste like salmon, so I don't want to overpower it. I don't want to kill it. So I want to cook it very gently, because salmon, as soon as it starts to heat too much, it gets dry.
Yeah, so
cook it very gently, for example, salmon. Then I'm going to mix, for example, it's fatty, I need some acidity, so either I'm going to put some citrus there. I need to add some spice, I would probably use either ginger or maybe some galangal. I don't know, things like that, that's the way I compose my dish. Yes. I test in my mind, I write it down,
yes.
And I compose my dish, and right away I know. The food for me has to be exciting. And food has to be clear to the people too. If you have more than 10 ingredients, it's over. People don't want to test it. For me, without the seasoning, the spices, I usually put 3 things together. On the clear things. Go back to the salmon. Salmon, maybe truffle, maybe mashed potato. Those are 3 simple ingredients, but yeah. They go so well together.
If you do it well, it's incredible.
It's incredible, because then you have the technique of cooking or slow baking your salmon. The mashed potato with the right amount of butter. The truffle will give that earthy aroma. I mean, those 3 elements are perfect for me.